by grants from Machias Savings Bank, the Total Service Bank, McDonald's Restaurants of Maine, Grant's Dairy, processing milk produced by Central, Eastern, and Northern Maine dairy farmers since 1902. Husson College, offering master's, baccalaureate, and associate degrees in business and professional studies. And R.H. Foster Incorporated, with locations in Machias, Hamden, Lisbon, and Caribou. Mobile distributors throughout Maine. It's the girls' Class C final game between the Skank Wolverines and the Callous Blue Devils. Now, let's join Lisa Richards, Keith McKean, and Bill McManus.
Good evening again, everyone. From the Bangor Auditorium, the Eastern Maine tourney winds down this evening, but not before two titles will be decided here in Class C. The first is a game between number one Callous and number two Skank for the Eastern Maine championship. And Lisa, the heel points standings hold up for C at least, and this should be a good contest.
Oh, it definitely should be. Both teams come in with identical 19-1 records, Keith, and neither team has played each other on the season, so I think maybe this is a little bit of a showdown about to happen here.
So the Eastern Maine Championship decided tonight, and Skank advances with a win over Penobscot Valley in the semifinal round. Callous defeating Katahdin 71-39. We witnessed the crowning of some D champions this afternoon. It was Washburn defeating Ashland in girls basketball in Class D. Washburn became the Eastern Maine champ, defeating favorite Ashland 61-48. It was number five Washburn over number two Ashland. And then in a boys' contest this afternoon, it was D-Ryle Stonington 55 and Washburn 45. So the Washburn girls will go on to the state championship, and the Washburn boys will not. The state finals in D will be played this Thursday night. So we hope you'll join us Thursday night for the state championship in Class D, with Washburn playing the Western Maine champion. In this game tonight, it should be very, very interesting to watch one of the best tall players in Eastern Maine, Stephanie Cotter, and the talented Skank Wolverines going against a pretty quick Callous squad.
Yes, we saw Callous really explode in the second half of their semifinal game, Keith, and as we said, a little bit of a showdown here. Fans probably not used to seeing Skank come in the number two position. They're wearing the dark jerseys tonight, and obviously, their tournament experience will be something that they rely on. But this Callous team showed how explosive they can be, Keith, and all their fans are here tonight, traveled up the airline road, and they're ready for this team.
You can hear the fans and the Skank band immediately behind us. You can see the Skank band on your screen. And the Skank cheerleaders are leading the crowd now, and trying to get the crowd fired up. And a good contingent on hand from Callous as well. In here to watch a couple of what should be good Class C games this evening. Skank versus Callous, followed by John Babs against Washington Academy, a boys contest. And so a lot of people will be coming in from the Bangor Brewer area to watch the John Babs team this evening. Number one against number two, Callous ended the season 17-1. So did Skank. They did not face each other on the season. Skank lost its one game to Class B Holton, and Callous lost one game to Woodland.
And we're about to get ready here, Keith.
Both
sets of fans. I don't know if everybody at home can hear them, but this place is packed tonight.
You can get a look at the pretty good crowd, and it's going to grow as the first game goes along. And a lot of people coming in from the local area for the John Babs team, for the John Babs Washington Academy game. And we're going to go to Norris Nickerson, the scorer's table now, for the starting lineup.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the championship games in Eastern Maine Class C basketball. This time, we'll introduce both teams. First, the visitors, Skank High School. First, the starters, number 32, Stephanie Cotter.
Cotter, the senior, 5'10".
Number 10, Stephanie Fisk.
Fisk, a senior, 5'5".
number 20, Don Mankowski.
Mankowski is a 5'4 senior.
Number 22, Laurie Spearin.
Laurie Spearin, 5'4 senior.
Number 42, Darcy Clark.
Clark is only a freshman.
Remaining 5'8. Players, number 40, Rita Floyd.
Floyd is a junior, 5'7.
Number 12, Amy Morin.
A freshman, 5'2.
Number 34, Christine Bigney.
Bigney coming out of the floor, 5'4 senior.
Number 30, Cynthia DeVoe.
DeVoe is a sophomore, 5'5.
Number 24, Mary Beth Currier.
Currier, sophomore, 5'10.
Number 44, Beth Martin.
Martin is a junior, standing 5'7.
Number 14, Wendy Hopkins.
And Hopkins, a senior at 5'3.
Shanks is coached by Steve Lavasser.
Coach Lavasser on your screen. The Wolverines in green.
Dallas High School.
Dallas in white and blue trim.
First, the starters. Number 23, Jennifer Panett.
Panett is a senior, 5'6.
Number 13, Kim Cole.
Cole is a senior, 5'8.
Number 25, Paula Clark.
A 5'8 senior.
Number 30, Allison Saunders.
Saunders is a junior, standing 5'5.
Number 14, Becky Mulholland.
Mulholland, the 5'10 sophomore.
Remaining players, number 32, Crystal Hinton.
Hinton is a senior, 5'7.
Number 21, Kobe Lyons.
Lyons, a 5'8 junior.
Number 10, Trisha Carter.
Carter is a sophomore, 5'3.
Number 22, Betsy Olson.
Betsy Olson.
Number 20, Julie Olson.
Julie Olson coming out.
Number 12, Wendy Rhodes.
Wendy Rhodes.
Number 31, Danielle Dupuis.
Danielle Dupuis, 5'9 sophomore.
And number 15, Melanie Lovett.
And Lovett is a 5'4
Dallas
sophomore.
Dallas is coached by Bob McShane.
Coach
the
Bob McShane.
The baseball game of Mr. Adams and Mr. McCatton.
Would you please stand while the state high school band plays our national anthem?
Championship last year. and the year before, and they've got just about everybody back. So there'll be no surprises whichever team wins this game. Two outstanding ball clubs. This is Komet with a shot.
We saw in that last semifinal game for Calais, they're a little slow getting off the start, but it looks like they're coming out ready tonight.
Darcy Clark, the freshman, with it. Gives it back out to Stephanie Fisk. She'll do the ball handling chores out front, setting up the play. Clark loses the ball, loses the handle, and gets it back to Spearham. Lori Spearham inside of Patterson. The foul line goes down inside, gives it to Mankowski. The interesting to see how Calais defends Connor, who is one of the premier ball players, of course, in the state. We've mentioned that before. She had 37 big points in the semifinal game.
Well, they're running a zone right now and trying to collapse on her.
She goes in against Cole, puts it up, rebound comes down. Fisk puts it off the backboard.
Remember that semifinal, it was Fisk that came up with a key foul shot at the end to ice the game for them.
Jennifer Finette gives it to Saunders. Inside it goes. Cole can't hang on and loses the ball. Becky Mulholland, number 14.
She had an excellent semifinal game, Keith.
Mulholland had 20 points in the semifinal game against Katahdin High School. Calais winning that game 71-39. Now a foul committed by Clark of Calais. And the first foul in the ball game.
And that was Spearham that got fouled. You're going to see that press. Calais likes to press. It helps build the intensity.
Mankowski will be putting the ball in play. We're tied at two. Eastern Maine C final. Connor will go up in the air over Mulholland. And Calais comes back on the fast break. Saunders is by herself.
See, that's what we saw a lot. We talked about how explosive they were. They like to run that break, and they really pass the ball well off the break.
The T for Calais, maybe trying to get Skank into a running game. Connor, long one-hander, good.
She says, okay, you're going to block up the inside, I'll take it from outside.
But a foot beyond the foul line, Jennifer Finette bring the ball in and cures for the Blue Devils. To Saunders, she loops it underneath, intended for Mulholland, knocked out of bounds by Skank. So, Calais will put the ball in play underneath their own basket. Coming out to Finette. Over on the left side. Inside it goes to Clark, and she loses the ball off her leg out of bounds.
Clark has a strong left hand, and she used that to her advantage earlier in the tournament, and we'll look for her to do the same in this game.
Pass comes up to Darcy Clark. She'll take the shot from the side of the lane. Nice shot by the freshman. Darcy Clark, a 5'8 freshman starting for Skank, along with four seniors.
Skank playing the man-to-man defense where we saw Calais coming up in the zone.
Saunders goes through and gets fouled by Mankowski.
A little contrast in styles there. Obviously trying to play them man-to-man here. And she starts the drive, and Mankowski comes over her shoulder. And Saunders on the line for two.
Her team down by two, 6-4.
It will be interesting to see how they set up to take care of Stephanie Carter down on this end. They've come out in a zone. And the only thing you have to worry about in the zone is Skank has the outside shooters in Mankowski and Spearham.
That's right, they connect. They have a good perimeter shooting team with Spearham, Mankowski, and Fisk from time to time. And I think Clark is able to put them up from a ways away. And now a foul being called on Saunders as she's closely guarding Stephanie Carter.
You know, once Stephanie Carter gets the ball, she's very difficult to defend. And I'm sure one of the things Calais is going to try to do is deny that entry pass to her.
Connor has awfully quick moves. Now it's all the way across. Mankowski is open. That's what they're going to try to do. Now, first coming to the basket is a shot blocked by Mulholland, but a quick right up and put up by Connor, and now it's up again by Fisk. Okay, an 8-5 ball game. Skank Wolverines ahead. Saunders to Kinnett. Inside, spinning around. Mulholland puts it up and off, knocks out of bounds, and touched by Callis.
Okay, we won't see the press off the turnover. They come back and they set up in the 2-3 zone.
It'll be interesting to see how much pressing Callis does this evening. Inside, Clark, back to Mankowski. She's open. They're going to try to get Mankowski hitting from outside and open up Connery.
You see on that rebound that time, Mulholland quickly looking down court, looking to see if they could run the break off if they didn't have it, so she dribbled out herself.
Inside, going up, and getting fouled by Connery.
That's when we talk about the left-hand advantage there. Clark pushed the ball up left-handed. She's able to protect the ball that way, whereas a lot of players you'd see put it up with their right hand in there, and they would never have scored on that foul. But she got fouled on the right side, put it up with her left, and she now has a possibility for the three-point play.
Now, Rita Floyd coming in the lineup for Skank, and Darcy Clark going to the bench. Floyd with the number 40, 5'7" junior, best coming back with it for the Wolverines. They lead by a point. Over to Spearin. Spearin will shoot from outside, too. And up to Floyd. On the other side, Connor. Rebound. Connor coming over the back.
And you can hear the crowd on that one. On the Callis side, anytime Stephanie Carter picks up a foul, they're going to go wild. They know she's one person they wouldn't like to see in the ball game, and she picked it up going over the back that time as Cole had inside position.
Sure, they spent a lot of time discussing what they're going to do with how they're going to try to prevent Stephanie Carter from piling up the points this evening. Cole misses. Mulholland puts it up in the end. 9-8 now, 1-point lead for Callis. Fisk, top of the circle, bounce pass to Mankowski on the left, cross court pass to Spearin, and it's blocked by Panette. Nice block.
Nice job moving back in the zone that time.
Mankowski looking into Carter. She finds her up and short and a foul.
And that foul's going to be called on Rita Floyd underneath.
Carter's shot was, are you looking now at the Callis bench?
That's Coach Bob McShane and his assistant Sonia Wedge.
Carter's shot that time was really, really short. And I don't know, maybe it was deflected or something, but she really didn't have enough on the ball. I guess it was partially knocked away. Now Saunders is back for Callis. Across the midcourt stretch, tied up and loses the ball. Callis maintains possession. And that has it back to Saunders. Throwing it in the middle by Floyd. Mankowski. Fisk. Looking down low. Now Mankowski takes the long one. And good position by Cole that time to get the rebound. Burnett goes through the corner. Now takes the long one handle off the rim. And Carter comes away with the rebound. 2:46 in the first period. A 9-8 ball game. Number one Blue Devils on top of the number two Skank Wolverines. Both teams 17-1 on the season. Mankowski's shot. It was picked out by Clark, and now she throws it off the heel of Cole. Cole didn't turn around in time to pick up the pass. And it goes astray, and Mankowski will put it back in play now for Skank. Cole didn't turn around that time to get the outlet pass and lost it away. Mankowski looking inside, back to Spearin. Underneath, intended for Floyd, but Floyd was pretty well covered up, and she couldn't get the pass into her, and it goes out of bounds. Cole will put the ball in play to Panette. Now Skank pressing, full court in the lineup now. For Skank is Amy Moore on number 12. This is Panette going in the lane, putting two defenders, and putting it off the glass and getting fouled.
Again, Keith, an excellent job guard by Panette, this time splitting the defenders. And again, watch the face of the player that's shooting. Her eyes do not come off the basket. That's good concentration. And the ball fell through for her because of that concentration.
Second foul on Mankowski. This is a shot after the basket, but believe it or not, Callis is already will be in the bonus situation. They are in the bonus situation. They go to the line next time for 1-1. And Callis has only committed two fouls, so Skank fouling early, getting in foul trouble, trying to slow Callis down. Connor, shot and a foul being called on Mulholland.
Mulholland had been doing a good job, but just a few seconds earlier to that, in fronting Stephanie Carter, but we see now that Carter was allowed to have that entry pass, and that's one of the things we talked about. You're not going to let her get the ball in there because she immediately turns to shoot the ball. And this time she drew the foul.
Okay, Carter puts that up and in. Again, she had 37 points in the semifinal game. A close one, Skank pulling on a close one over Penobscot Valley the other night, 63-59. And the ball lost out, it's Callis, the Callis ball. Skank bringing full court pressure now.
That's Hinton in the ball game now, number 32.
Crystal Hinton is a senior, 5'7", number 32. Burnett with it. Burnett doing most of the ball handling chores for the Blue Devils. Now Mulholland's shot is off the rim, and see who picks it up.
Mankowski.
To Fisk. 1:30 in period number one. This is Fisk. Amy Morin, number 12. Tipped away. They're picked up by Floyd. Back to Morin. To Fisk into Carter for the spin around jumper. That's quick. Quick movement that time. Free Carter up with a shot. Okay, Panette coming back. 108. Long one. The two. In and out. Rebound, Connor, the outlet pass to Mankowski. Bounces over to Morin, but she took steps. Traveling going in.
Yes, she did, but Morin did a nice job of filling that other lane on the break that time, and Mankowski knew she was coming, just unable to convert on it.
Morin's another Skank freshman, 5'2", number 12. Panette with it, number 23 for the Blue Devils, to Crystal Hinton, 43 seconds. Tipped away by Floyd, and it goes out of bounds. And knocked out by Clark of Callis.
Rita Floyd showing good defensive hustle that time. Coming into the ball game now for Skank is Mary Beth Curry in number 24.
So Skank using a lot of substitutions early, trying different combinations. Courier is a 5'9 sophomore, number 24. Fisk still handling the ball out front. Mankowski will go back and forth along the baseline from the right corner to the left corner, and she can put up the three-point shot.
He's also in the lineup now for Callis is Danielle Dupuy, number 31. She's a 5'9 sophomore.
Inside, lost away. I think it was tipped out by Callis. Skank will maintain possession. Mankowski looking for someone to get it into. Cross-court pass to Mankowski. Up and off. Rebound comes down to Callis. Connor taking a rest right now out of the lineup. Connects. Long one is off. The foul on Clark.
Clark came over the back that time. Interesting, as Stephanie Carter goes out, so does Becky Mulholland, who had the chore of watching her in the inside of that zone. Clark this time didn't have a good position on the rebound, and she pushed Floyd, but no shots. Next foul will put them in the bonus.
So the two tall players going to get a rest as the period winds down. Mankowski tries again from deep, and the gun goes off, ending period number one, 12-11, and we'll be back in a moment.
War bonds, pin-up girls, USO tours, Armed Forces Radio, and the Hollywood Canteen. You'll find all of these and more on Entertaining the Troops, American Entertainers in World War II.
It's been a long, long...
Tuesday, March 14th at 8.
You'll never know how many dreams I'd...
This is Maine High School Tournament Basketball on the stations of the Maine Public Broadcasting Network, a service of the University of Maine system.
Okay, Callis and Skink locked in a real battle at this point, with Callis leading 12-11. Second period about to get underway. Hinton will bring it in for Callis in the white uniforms and the blue trim. She gives it to Kinnett.
She's both Carter and Mulholland back in the ballgame now.
Inside it comes to Mulholland, with Carter guarding her. Stephanie Carter is a little reluctant to get in foul trouble or to shut her off from going through there right now. Now it's stolen away. Fisk coming down. Hands off to Floyd, who goes up and over. Too far. And the rebound comes down to Callis. Kinnett comes back. Callis with a one-point lead. Callis with four team fouls. Skink with five. Callis in the one-and-one. Hinton misses the long bomb.
Coach Steve Levasseur on the Skink bench with instruction for his team.
Quite a few fouls in that first period. Both teams reaching the bonus for a situation early in the second period. Carter's jump shot. Clean.
They're going to have to deny her the ball. They can't allow that pass in there because she's doing one of two things. She's either scoring or she's drawing the foul.
All net. Now Kinnett with the ball. Try the left side. They come back out front with it. Nicole over to Mulholland. Back out to Hinton. Hinton, a three-point shooter for Callis. Looking inside. Nice fake by Mulholland. She loses the ball. That comes back to Callis. Into Mulholland, and she goes right up there off to the side of the backboard. Kicked around. Stephanie Fisk has it for Skink. And now she traveled. She knew it right away.
Yes, she did. We'll see some full-court pressure by Skink now. Full-court man-to-man.
Amy Moore and the number 12, the freshman, coming in to help do some dogging in backcourt. Kinnett goes to the side of the lane, up off the rim, and the rebound comes down to Floyd. She hands off to Moore. Back to Floyd. Fisk brings it all the way up. Moore and bounce pass inside to Floyd, back to Amy Moore. She's open. She'll take the shot and off the rim, and the rebound comes down to Callis. Quickly, Kinnett comes down one-on-one and goes right up left-handed.
Nice left-handed shot that time. If she'd used her right, she probably would have been stuck. Nice job with the left hand.
Right up and rolled it in. Mankowski, Fisk, with a spin-around jumper, and she's fouled by Mulholland.
No, that's going to be on Dupuy, I believe, Keith.
Dupuy from the side, maybe.
Yes, it was. Again, there's that entry pass to Carter, and Dupuy comes over on the side and picks up her first foul. She's checking out of the ball game now as Clark has come back in along with Saunders. Hinton and Dupuy. And Carter makes her first foul shot.
Tied at 14. Rebound across. Callis to Saunders. She'll slow it up. Fourth court. Gives it to Cole. Across to Saunders. And in the corner to Mulholland. Mulholland takes. Thinks better of going inside. Mulholland being guarded closely by Stephanie Carter. Low there. Now Mulholland sticks her hand up looking for the pass, and she and Carter right nose to nose down.
Yeah, she's trying to post up inside on Carter, and Carter doing a fairly good job of denying the ball.
Inside it goes to Mulholland. She loses it away. Mankowski races to the outside to set it up for Skink.
Good defense by Skink that time.
Mankowski gets it back, and she's open. Having a little trouble with her shot this evening. She's a good outside shooter, but hasn't been able to connect this evening. And now the ball is tied up and a foul.
It's going to be Saunders picking up that foul.
You get the feeling this one could go right right to the wire. Very close.
Neither team shooting well right now, Keith. From the floor, we've had a lot of missed shots. But a little tension. As we said, first time these two teams have met on the season, and I'm sure they've heard a lot about each other, but this is kind of the big showdown here.
They do look pretty even in terms of ability. It could be a close one, but who knows. Up and in.
They're going to have to box her out.
So we're doing a pretty good job early, and now Connor's been able to get free with quick movements. 16-14, 4:35 and a half. Inside intended for Mulholland and broken up by Skink. Maybe trying too hard to get inside. Now, a three-point attempt by Connor. Good.
Inside and out.
Jeez. Skink goes up 19-14. Connett. The call into Park for the left-handed shot.
Much better that time. As you said, Keith, I think they were trying to force it a little bit into Mulholland, who had Carter on her. This time they went to the other side and went to Clark and had better luck.
Kicked out of bounds by Cole. Callis was trying to go inside to Mulholland, and she was guarded closely by Carter on the right side down low. And they tried to get in there a couple of times, and the ball was knocked away or stolen.
Well, what was happening, Keith, Carter was denying the ball, so they tried to lob it over ahead, and then she'd get help from the weak side as she throws up another three. Just missed off the front of the rim. And that's going to be Callis' ball.
3:45, 19-16. Some pressure again in backcourt from the Wolverines. This is Finette with the ball. Jennifer Finette. He's up and off by Connett. And the rebound comes down to Clark. No room to shoot. Connett back with it. Moves in, puts it up and off. Rebound, Carter. To Sturin. And the Wolverines hustle back. Sturin is open. And he puts it in. So they tried Mankowski a few times, and now they go to Sturin, and she puts it down. They may look for Sturin to do some shooting.
Well, as we said earlier, they've got at least three players from the outside that can hit the shots, and all that's going to do is help them by it'll free up Carter on the inside.
Now, Mulholland puts it up, sort of off balance there. She bumped into her defender and backed off and just rolled it up and got the roll.
A little bit of a fadeaway that time.
Behind you, Sam! Behind you!
Mulholland denying that one.
Clark tried to whip it into Carter, and the ball was knocked loose, but it'll be Skank ball. Cynthia DeVoe, number 30, 5'5 sophomore, is in the lineup for Skank. Mankowski is getting the rest. Connor goes between two defenders, and she may have traveled.
She traveled that time. Keithley allowed the pass into Carter that time, but three Callis defenders right there to shut her off in the lane.
This is Hinton in backcourt. She will come down and bomb away. Put in some three pointers in the tournament. Inside the Clark.
So Clark doing the job for him offensively right now. Just does a nice job on that left side.
Okay, Fisk setting it up into Connor. She'll go down low and put it up, and it rolls in and out. And a foul being called on Skank on the rebound.
And Mulholland's going to shoot the 1-1 on the other end, too.
Darcy Clark picking up the foul.
And that's her first foul. We'll see Carter take the shot as it rolls off. Mulholland right there for the rebound.
Both
and
teams.
She was fouled. Darcy Clark, as you said, keeps picking up her first foul. Mankowski checking back into the game. Going out is Cynthia DeVoe.
Both teams in the 1-1 very early in the bonus situation, very early in this game. Ties it at 21. There's Mulholland. Puts it through. Becky Mulholland is a sophomore. 5'10", 20 points in the quarterfinal game. And she makes it Callis 22, Skank 21. Quickly, they get it over to Mankowski. She looks inside. Now, straight away by Connett. And she holds up and waits for the offense to get down there with her.
Good idea that time.
She saw three defenders back and decided to set it up. Mahone with a long one off the rim and rebound to Skank. Coming the other way, Mankowski. Fast break, hands off to Clark, and a little off balance that time, a little out of control. Didn't work. Clark comes away with it. And the high dribble puts it up. Rebound tipped up, put up and in by Mahone, and the foul.
Quite a turnaround that time on that series, Keith. Skank came down with a three-on-one break, and they weren't able to convert. And Clark, a little out of control as she throws this shot up, but there's Becky Mulholland for the rebound. And the concentration again that we saw, ball went in on the line now to see if she can make it a three-point play.
Both teams looked a little out of control. Skank, when they came down on their fast break, Floyd had it, but she put it up sort of, she was sort of off balance, and the same thing coming the other way with Clark. 25-21 now, Callis by four, long one by Mankowski, this one goes down.
Just inside the line now for two.
Coming up to halftime at this Class C final, Eastern Maine final, Hinton to the net, 55 seconds. Mulholland, Hinton, and Cole, going to work it around here. The net goes in the lane and
gets a wrong rebound.
Throws it up and gets it back and hooks it up. And Connie gets the rebound. Quickly, though, that Mankowski pass is too long and out of bounds.
38 seconds. They may have been trying to look for the last shot that time or wanted to, but forced the ball down long.
Mankowski pressing in backcourt, but Burnett brings it in on the right side now, going toward the corner. That comes back out to Hinton, to Burnett. As time winds down, maybe they'll go for the last shot here. Mulholland fakes, tries to get by Connor, but can't do it. Now back out to Cole, to Hinton.
I'm sure they'd like to go in with the lead at halftime, and as they're now inside 10
and
seconds.
Clark, a spin-around jumper, and a foul being called on Floyd. And Clark, Darcy Clark picking up another foul.
So they're going to get the ball inside to Clark here. Panette passes into Clark, makes her move with that left hand, and she was blocked by Darcy Clark, who picked up her second. And now Paula Clark is on the line. 5 seconds to go in the half, and she can put her team up.
Paula Clark at 5'8", does a lot of the inside play for Callis. Now Mankowski can't get the handle coming the other way. And so a pretty good first half of high school basketball, 25-23.
Okay, right now we'd like to take a look at that defense that Callis is using to try to stop Stephanie Carter. Bill?
Well, with that, Lisa, what's happening is that you can see the Callis defense is sitting in a zone. We've drawn this on the diagram where they've almost framed it in. And Stephanie Carter is coming right down the middle. As we proceed a little bit on by frame, you'll see the Skank girls come down and throw the ball to Mankowski over here on the wing. And you're going to see the Callis girls make an adjustment. They're all going to kind of collapse in, and they're protecting their defense, and they're trying to cover up with Stephanie Carter right there. You'll see him drop down. The way to beat this is for Mankowski to throw a bounce pass down on the girl on the baseline and then have Carter cut to the basket and they can bounce it back. You can't do it because the Callis people are playing too close. If we go a little bit further, you'll see that what Skank is going to do is to draw Callis out to Mankowski out on the wing. They come out after her. They're going to feed the ball down low. They're going to feed it back to Mankowski. There it goes into Carter. That's what they're after, and then the foul is going to occur, and she's going to go on the line for a two-shot. That's basically what Skank has been doing when Stephanie Carter is in the paint, Lisa.
Well, thank you, Bill. Real nice diagram that time on the chalkboard. You could see what both teams are doing offensively and defensively. And so with the score, 25-23, Callis on top at halftime. We'll be back to the Bangor Auditorium in just a moment.
Production and broadcast of the high school B, C, and D basketball tournament games on MPBN are made possible in part by grants from McDonald's Restaurants of Maine, Grant's Dairy,
processing milk produced by Central, Eastern, and Northern Maine dairy farmers since 1902. Husson College, offering master's, baccalaureate, and associate degrees in business and professional studies. R.H. Foster Incorporated, with locations in Machias, Hamden, Lisbon, and Caribou. Mobile distributors throughout Maine. And Machias Savings Bank, the total service bank.
Okay, back in the auditorium, the Skank Wolverines and cheerleaders going through their faces on the court. Two titles being decided here this evening. This one between Callis and Skank. The Class C Girls Championship game and the Class C Boys Championship coming up after this game between John Babst and Washington Academy. Earlier today, it was the Washburn Boys 55, Washburn 45. And the Washburn girls upsetting number 2 Ashland, 61-48. So Ashland, Washburn came all the way through in Class D again. They won the state championship last year, and the Skank Wolverines trying to do that here. They won 2 in a row with the same group of kids, pretty much, and they're trying to do it for the third time in a row. But they're facing a real stiff challenge from Callis.
Yes, from what we've seen in the first half, Keith, both teams very evenly matched. As we talked about and showed in that diagram just before we went on break, the problem that Callis is having right now is the entry pass into Carter. Skank is using very good ball movement, really getting a lot of people involved in the offense, and then they are able to dish it in to Stephanie Carter. So once she gets the ball inside that paint, very dangerous, as she's either going to draw the foul or usually she scores from that position. So I'm sure one of the things that Coach Bob McShane for Callis is going to discuss is how are they going to deny that entry pass into Carter. You know, they need to get some more people, force Mankowski and Spearin and Fisk and some of the outside shooters to play their part and make them score for Skank. And on the other end, I think one of the problems they were having was they were really trying to pound the ball into Mulholland a lot, and we found that Paula Clark on the other side was just as effective. And then they started to go into Clark a little bit more, and as they did that, again, that freed up Mulholland, and a good scoring, a balanced scoring attack by Callis in that first half.
Just they had Stephanie Carter playing on Mulholland, and so they did go into Clark and had more success. Any chance that Carter may take a different, if they keep going to Clark, any chance that Carter may switch over and get on that side and watch Clark a little closer?
Well, they may have to. What was happening was, as we talked about a little bit earlier, they were trying to deny that ball into Mulholland, and they were getting good help side defense from Rita Floyd when she was in there. So as they tried to lob the ball over Mulholland, you know, for her to take it back door, Floyd was right there to shut it off. That can work either way because, you know, they may switch it up and they may put her over on Clark, but I think they're going to want to try to keep Carter with Mulholland, basically because they're very comparable in size.
I guess anybody playing Skank has got to decide whether to really do a job on Stephanie Carter or just expect Stephanie Carter's going to get so many points and watch everybody else, and that's probably that's the problem that everybody seems to have playing Skank.
It certainly is. You know, Carter has been able to do it all for them so far in this first half. They've had some scoring from the outside, but Carter has carried most of that scoring load. We'll take a look at that right now. Keith and Morskink, Carter, as we just mentioned, she's got 14 points in that in the first half. She's followed by Stephanie Fisk with 4, and Mankowski, Spearin, and Clark have each added 1 bucket, and that's their total of 23 points. On the other side, we see a much more balanced scoring attack for Callis. Becky Mulholland had 9, Jennifer Kinnett had 7, Clark on the inside had 6, and Allison Saunders had 3. So one thing you may look is for Skank to get a little bit more balance in their attack. Let's look at the field goal percentages for Skank. They shot 30% from the floor. As we mentioned, a little cold on the outside there for a while. They were 10 for 33 for 30%. Callis was 10 for 27, 37%. So right around the same on that one. Free throws, Skank 3 for 5 for 60%. Callis 5 for 8 for 62%. Skank had 7 turnovers, and we saw a few of those cost them right at the end of the half, and Callis had their 4, so pretty evenly matched. Right now we'd like to go to Bill McManus.
Lisa, thank you very much. With me I have part of the cheering squad from Schenck High School, and it's the cheerleading advisor, Joni Lowell. Joni, thank you for being here. Can you tell the audience a little bit about the cheerleading competition? Because a lot of them think it's only the boys and girls playing basketball, but you have a competition that you go to.
Yes, cheerleading has now become a sport, and we're really proud to be a part of this, and we work all year with gymnastics and tumbling and choreography. There are many things that they grade us on for precision and timing and whatnot, and really, cheerleading has really come a long way, and we, like we said, we start with going to clinics and summer camps and whatnot in the summer to try to get ahead before the season even starts.
Joni, when they started out, you said that they take, they have like a regional playoffs or cheer-offs or however you want to call those things, and then from there they take some teams and they go to the state championships, which is really like what the girls and the boys do in the East and West. You brought with you your senior captain or one of your seniors. Why don't you introduce yourself and tell me, what do you do to get ready for cheering at the Eastern Maine Tournament? First of all, your name.
My name is Trisha Hale, and I'm a senior at Schenck. And to get ready, we just practice a lot.
What about signs and things like that? Do you do those back in school, or do you have any other people make the signs that you bring down here?
We make them ourselves. We just take a practice, and we take time out of a practice and make the signs, take our time on the signs.
How much in the summer now? A lot of the basketball players, Joni, practice in the summer. Do the cheerleaders practice in the summer, or a lot of people think when they go to school that they just start right out?
Well, what we're going to do this year, we're taking the team as a team to cheerleading camp is what we're doing, to learn choreography and tumbling and tricks and whatnot.
That's great. Lisa, we're coming back to you in just a minute, but I think the people at home have to realize that cheerleading is getting just as technical as boys and girls basketball in Eastern Maine. Can you tell me who's going to win the game?
We are, of course.
Well, who's we are? We don't know who that is. Joni, thank you very much. I appreciate you taking time, and good luck to you.
Thank you. We'll see you at the state championship.
Lisa?
Okay, thank you very much, Billy. A couple of very confident Schenck fans there. And we have seen some outstanding cheerleading here in the tournament, some great halftime routines. We're getting ready to start this second half. Again, Callis on top right now. It's a very fast-paced and fairly even first half. That's what you might expect, Keith, when the number one and two teams come in to be in the finals of this Eastern Maine Class C tournament.
Well, if the second half is anything like the first half, it's going to go right to the wire, and it'll be a matter of, I guess, Callis continuing to try to find the answer to Stephanie Connor. That's pretty hard to do. I think when they started the game, they had her pretty well bottled up, and she was unable to get free, and when Mankowski and Spearin were unable to hit, they stayed on Connor, but ended up getting free anyway.
Yeah, well, they had good ball movement, and you see Mankowski taking the shot there, and Mulholland with the rebound. They're going to need to start. I don't think that Stephanie Carter can do it all. We've seen in past tournaments where the outside current has come in and really helped to lift them late in the game, and I think that's one thing we're going to have to see Schenck do. We saw a very balanced scoring attack for Callis, whereas Schenck really relied on Stephanie.
Okay, Clark just put it down for Callis. Now we're at the other end. Schenck puts it up and in. And again, it's a two-point game. Callis 27, Schenck 25.
That's the scoring we're talking about right there. Spearin and Mankowski out front, along with Fisk.
That'll really open it up if they begin to hit. Okay, this is Finette looking for someone. Inside it goes to Saunders, who goes in the lane, puts it up. Got it with a rebound, quickly down court now. Coming to the middle on the fast break, taking the long jump shot for two beyond the foul line. She had a three-pointer earlier.
How many times do you see that? Your center lead the break and then pull up right for a foul shot, for a shot at the foul line.
Battle good. Saunders picks it up and fouls. And so Schenck will get it back. Connor came right to the middle that time on the fast break, and they filled the lanes, but she took the shot herself from beyond the foul line last time down. This is Mankowski. Fisk. Spearin on the right side. Fisk number 10 looking inside. Over to Mankowski. Underneath.
Oh, nice play.
Nice play by
Darcy Clark.
Freshman Darcy Clark. net with it for Callis. They trailed by two. Looking down inside, comes to Clark. Back to connect to Saunders. In the corner, now in underneath the Clark, for the spin around, jump shot.
Not a very tall player on the inside is Paula Clark, but she certainly does the job in there.
Pretty impressive inside ball player for 5'8". 5'8 senior, Clark. Now there's a bomb by Mankowski, making it 31-29. Burnett comes back for the Blue Devils. Over to Saunders. Back out to Burnett. Long one by Burnett. Is off the rim. It's held high and tied up between Mulholland and Connor.
And possession goes back to Callis.
Cole will put the ball in play underneath the Callis basket. Comes out to Saunders, to Burnett. Pass to Mulholland for the long one. Nice shot by Mulholland from the side of the foul line.
Left all alone that time, and we've seen her shoot from the foul line in the free throw situation, and that time she takes the jumper.
Okay, Spoon now can't find room, gets it back to Fisk. Mankowski bounce pass in the corner. Clark comes back out to Fisk for the jump shot.
So right now, what we talked about, Skank's able to do, they're getting other players involved in the scoring, and that's taking a little bit of the pressure off Carter.
However, they're trading baskets now as Callis continues to keep the pace up. Inside.
Good move that time. Excellent pass, and Clark dished the ball off to Mulholland. We're going to see it here. Entry pass comes into Clark. Clark makes a move, dishes to Mulholland along the baseline. Ball fake. She goes up. And again, one thing this Callis team does very well is they follow through on their shot, Keith, and they... They've had the many opportunities to convert on three-point plays.
Becky Mulholland has been getting the job done inside for Callis. She's a sophomore, 5'10". Fisk. Hugh Mankowski pulled that long one again. And Clark with a rebound. Tied at 33. Burnett comes down with 4:17 showing on the clock in the third period. And Mulholland was pushed out of bounds.
She had nowhere to go on that.
She went up and Clark came against her and she came down out of bounds. Fisk. The ball outside. Long one by Spoon off the rim. Mankowski back into Clark.
Since we mentioned that at halftime, Keith, I think all four of the other players have now scored.
Skank beginning to get good balance.
It must have hurt us.
35-33, but Callis is hitting from this end as well. Saunders puts it up and off, and the rebound taken down by Connell. She clears it to Fisk. Racing down court. Stops the pop at foul line. And the rebound down to Spoon. Fisk almost running away. And Kowski just puts it up outside.
Again, Callis still in that zone. Mulholland trying to deny the ball to Carter.
Duren loops it into Carter. She'll go left. Put it in.
They can't allow that entry pass. And Callis having a very difficult time now stopping the ball from getting inside to Carter.
37-33. Jonathan Burnett, 2:57. Clark with a faking. Wants to go up against Carter, but not a very good position to do so. Carter gets the rebound. And the Callis fans come to their feet.
Well, that's a good call. I think we'll probably see that. Jerry Adams right on the call. And Clark gets called for, Saunders gets called for reaching in there. Got her on the arm. Today's ref, Jerry Adams from Holton and Linda McCallum from Ashland.
37-33, Fisk with the ball, Stern back to Fisk. 2:35, and third number three. Now it's inside the corner, she'll take the jump shot and miss. Well, she hasn't missed too many in the last few minutes. This is Burnett. wants to get something going. Puts it in. Nice shot by Knapp moving in the lane.
Big basket that time. They're going to need to stay close to Skenk. They don't want to let any momentum get built up here.
Skenk with a four-point lead. There's from the corner of Mankowski. They're leaving her open over here. She puts it in.
That's the thing you can't do. That's one thing that's pretty impressive about this Skenk team. Everybody talks about Carter, but it's really a well-balanced team.
Now back the other way, Bennett stuffs one down. It's 41-37.
We'll see if they come out on it.
Very fine. Picks it up. Darcy Klein.
I'd say at this point they're shooting a little higher than the 30% they shot in the first half.
They've really improved in this half. And Mahalan goes inside to Clark, and she puts it in. So a pretty torrid pace right now. I don't think they can keep this up. Spearin. Mankowski's open again on the left side, but finally they go over to her, and she puts it up. They're leaving her open on that left side.
Well, this may force them to come out of their zone. We'll see what effect it does have, Keith.
Spearin connected earlier, and they went over to prevent her from shooting, and now Mankowski's been putting them down from out there on the other side. Now Clark puts it up from the lane.
Hey, both teams battling right now, number one and number two, and 46 seconds left to go in this third period, which has been a great period of basketball, Keith.
Now Spearin off the rim, Clark with the rebound. The field goal percentage much better this period than it was in the first half.
And I think we're going to work for the last shot here.
Hinton with it. 26 seconds in the third period. Clark, Callis, and a foul on Spearin.
Reaching in. You hate to have your kids pick up a foul with only 20 seconds left to go in the quarter. And the ball came in to Clark. And Spearin dropping down to help out, reached in, and we're going to get the ball inside to Clark. Oh, it would have been a pretty play. She just couldn't find the handle, and Carter leads the break.
Carter coming down the middle and puts it up and off, and she's fouled.
Fouled by Connect.
Skenk hanging on to a 45-41 lead with 12 seconds.
See Stephanie Carter running the break, as mentioned before. Rather unusual to see the big player doing that, but obviously it's very effective for Skenk.
She does it like she's done it a lot before, probably at practice.
Yeah, that would have been a big basket down here on the other end, Keith. Callis getting the ball down low, and as they, the lane was wide open for Clark, she just couldn't hang on to it.
And Carter pops it up, and it's off. 46-41, 10 seconds. Time for Callis to get something on the board here quickly. 5 seconds. Clark's going to put it up and off. Mahalan has time, and the gun goes on. And after three, it's 46-41. We'll be back in a moment.
Anne of Green Gables. A remarkable young girl whose imagination and red hair cause her no end of trouble. An orphan, taken in by an elderly brother and sister, she grows from an awkward girl to a mature young woman. Megan Follows, Colleen Dewhurst, and Richard Farnsworth in Anne of Green Gables on WonderWorks.
Join us Sunday, March 5th at 1:45.
Maine High School Tournament Basketball, here on the stations of the Maine Public Broadcasting Network, a service of the University of Maine system.
Okay, I think the story in the third period was Mankowski getting open on the side and extending, giving Skenk a bit of a lead, allowing them to pull ahead by 5 points.
We just saw an excellent third period of basketball. Both teams are really starting to heat up from the floor, and good battle on both ends.
Spearin gets it inside, comes to Connor, spin off, next shot. 48-41, Callis has got to put a stop to that in a hurry. Not lost out of bounds. Knocked down by Callis. Hinton getting a hand on it last. And Callis wants a timeout right now. Bob McShane.
Sonya Wedge helping out there. Remember, former University of Maine star. Really going to have to deal with this Skank pressure right now. They came right out full court press, able to get the turnover. And there's Coach Steve Levasseur in his huddle.
Both teams came out shooting the lights out in the third period. And Skank, however, was able to get the better of it.
Well, the key
outside shooting.
Yeah, the key to it was that other players got involved in the scoring. So now you not only have to watch Stephanie, but the others are contributing as well. And now you don't, when the pass goes on the outside, you don't know, is she trying to pass it to Stephanie, or is the girl going to take the shot?
Skank Wolverine putting the ball in play. And Don Mankowski, number 20, gets it to Stephanie Fisk.
Staying with that zone.
Fisk and loses the ball back for it. So Kellett gets it back, trailing by 7. Hinton will put the ball in play, guarded by Mankowski, and she comes in to connect. Look for them maybe to try Hinton outside, open up the middle for Clark, and Hinton puts it down.
Key to that shot was good ball rotation. Good backspin on that ball, a little bit off, but caught the rim and it rolled in for her.
The lead is cut to 5. Mankowski has it. To Fisk. 7:15 to go in the game. Potter back to Fisk. And jump shot is up and off by Clark. Rebound Skank. Big offensive board. Connor bottled up, but she takes a shot, it's blocked, and she's tied up. Danae Panette got a hand on it.
Good call by the officials that time. We had 3 people on Stephanie Carter. They played good defense, didn't reach, but when they saw the ball, they blocked the shot.
Nice block shot by Panette from behind Carter, preventing her from going up. This is Panette with the ball back at the other end. Cole looking at Wood Mahomet. It's in the park and still go left again and put it in.
We keep repeating ourselves that that left hand is the key there. She can protect the ball with her body and lay it up to the left hand.
The fact that Hinton was able to hit from outside may have helped open up the clock that time down. Mankowski to Fisk. Mankowski. Shot is in. For 2, she was inside the line. 5-point lead again. And now Panette with it. Down in underneath. Mulholland tries to get it over to Clark, and it's tipped away, but Hinton comes up with it. Now Panette goes inside, running right here. Wow!
Thank you, she says. Little out of control that time.
She was almost straight out above the floor when she shot that one.
Still counts as 2.
Connor now down underneath. They're leaving Clark open, but she misses.
Too far under that time.
2 people on Connor, and she tried to get it into Clark. Now it's Panette the other way quickly again, but rushing her shot and a foul after the shot.
That's going to be the 3rd foul on Paula Clark. That time Panette came right down on the drive and pulled up. The only problem with that is she didn't have any rebounders in position. Paula Clark fighting for position ends up fouling.
Panette pulling the trigger a little quickly that time. Skank getting it back. Mankowski down to Clark. To Connor. Spins, goes between 2 people and puts up a jump shot. They keep piling up the points again here this evening. Now it's lost out of bounds by Skank. After the steal, or the attempted steal.
A couple of substitutions coming in. Rita Floyd comes in to replace Clark.
Saunders back in the lineup, number 30 for Callis. And Hinton goes to the bench.
Still a 5-point ball game.
Jennifer Panette will do the ball handling chores for Callis. Saunders. And Saunders goes to Clark, who has cut her off on the left side this time. They have got Stephanie Carter down there. Watching that pass on her.
And Clark
to foul.
Carter picks up that foul on Clark. clock shut off the first time, and she kicks it back outside. And then as the defense shifts out, Sparin goes out. Clark able to come in, and Carter gets her on the left arm. Paula Clark on the line for some big foul shots here with 4:50 left to go in the game.
But Skank has good news and bad news about having Carter down on Clark. She does a more effective job playing defense, but she also picks up fouls herself. And Clark puts it through. It's a two-point game now with 4 minutes, 50 seconds remaining. Fisk. To Vankowski, back to Fisk, almost stolen away, and a foul on Saunders.
Keith, I think we're a little bit of a discrepancy on the floor. The clock right now says 52-50, but I think maybe a few too many points may have been put up.
Probably should be 52-48.
I think so. We just said it was a 5-point lead, and now all of a sudden
one basket didn't cut it down that much. Okay, Ian underneath and getting fouled through to Floyd. So Floyd will go on the line for two shots.
In a situation like that, Keith, with a discrepancy with the clock, what they will do is they'll go over to the table to the official scorer, and I believe that's Lionel Alley over at the table. And he keeps a running score, and if there is any question on the clock, they will go to that running score, and that is the official score.
Well, the crowd is pointing and yelling on the Skank side, so they think two more points to put up for Dallas than they should have up there.
And they'll check that soon. I'm not sure if anybody on the floor has had that brought to their attention yet.
The rebound coming down to Panett. 4:23 to go. Well, it would be too bad to see a game like this go right down to the gun and still not know what the score is if it's this close.
That foul's going to be on Floyd trying to deny the pass in. I believe they are going to check the clock. Hinton takes the ball outside trying to give it in to Mulholland. And Floyd picks up that foul. They're checking the running score now.
Can you imagine how the fans would feel if they thought their team was tied with about 10 seconds to go and they were behind by two?
Well, we'll let you know what happens with that. Right now, the score on the clock is 52-50. Skank on top with 4:02 left.
Fisk, Indicato, jump shot. Rolled off and a foul. Clock still showing 52-50 in favor of Skank. Left-handed, but she usually goes to her left. This time she went to her right.
Hinton on the second attempt, it is the second shot off that, and Clark getting the third offensive board there.
A real battler. Paula Clark, 5'8 senior, on the line, puts it through. Well, they're not going to. They put the foul shot up on the Callis side, but they still haven't put the Skank foul shot up.
Okay, they're asking for a towel right now. Maybe something on the floor. Maybe where somebody fell down or something. And I think Coach Steve Levasseur may have just asked the official to check the score. Bill McManus is over at the table. Maybe he can find out what's going on. We'll let you know as soon as we find out.
The Skank fans think that a basket was put up for Callis that shouldn't have been up there. By the same token, Skank got a foul shot. It was not put up there. Maybe they're...
Okay, maybe we can find out from Bill McManus what the discrepancy is.
Lisa, the only thing I found out over here, the running score by the scorebook does say 52-51. The Skank fans are questioning the foul down here, which was about 30 seconds ago, where the girl did put the ball in the basket, and they counted it. I'm not sure on the foul shot, but I'm going to check out when we get to halftime.
Okay, thank you very much, Billy.
Well, the score says 54-51. We've got 3:05 left to go in the game, and here's a shot that's up and off by Cole, taken by Mankowski of Skank.
As you mentioned before, Keith, that running score is the official score, so the score is 54-51.
Okay, let's hope they continue to light up the boards when the ball gets through the basket. Here's Connor.
Big now as they are up by three, and she can have a chance to increase the lead. You see that Callis wants a timeout now. Ball going inside to Carter. Again, able to get that entry pass in. She makes the move through the baseline, and we can see clearly right there Mulholland coming across and getting her on the wrist.
This game appears to be everything fans were hoping it would be. Number one goes against number two. Callis number one, Skank number two. Of course, Skank is repeating all the players, just about, I guess, who won the state championship last year and the year before. In 1987, it was Skank 57, Livermore Falls 46. And last year, Skank 77, Erskine Academy 52.
Okay, while we have this chance right here, we'd like to let, going back over to Bill to see what's going on over at the scorer's table. Bill?
The only thing we could find out over here that Lionel Alley and Hal Sewell are saying is that Skank did question that basket that went in down at that end. There was no foul shot made at the other end. She missed both of them. One was an air ball, and that's what they people are. The score stands as 54-51 going into the fourth quarter.
Okay, great. Thank you very much, Bill. And Carter on the line right now to try to increase that three-point lead. And she does.
55. And 56. 5 points, 2:45. Skank pressure coming on Tanet, and a foul on Fisk, maybe.
Boy, they're going to give him the chances right here, putting him on the line. The pressure in the backcourt's nice if you can force the turnover, but what you don't want to do is pick up those backcourt fouls. You want to play just a good defense, good position that time. Play it with your feet. Force her either to travel or to double dribble in that situation.
Fisk saw Tanet go behind her back on the dribble and thought she could steal it.
I think so.
Mulholland goes back up, and Carter throws it for Skank. Fisk coming down.
Going to have to make those foul shots down the stretch.
3:28. Fisk back and forth in front on the dribble. Now to Connor. She is in there and puts it up and in. Awfully hard to stop. Really not much you can do down here to stop her.
She just continues to get better. She's developed a few different moves to the basket this year. I think some real quality moves, which has added to her game.
Okay, Tanet goes in the lane and puts it up and doesn't get the roll. Connor with a rebound, double team. It gets out, now she comes dribbling down court. Good ball handler. This inside to Connor. She's going to try to do a number on Callis now if she can to put it out of reach.
She traveled that time.
58-51, Skank by 7. Ooh, dangerous pass into Tanet. Skank gets it back. Mankowski to Fisk.
Okay, I think what we're going to...
Oh, long one by Mankowski off the rim. And Clark goes right back up with it. So Skank going to the basket still. Now fouling on Mahalan.
Good call by the official. Jerry Adams saw that from across the court. Bob McChinney wants a timeout here. 1:22 left to go. Skank has pulled out. They're up by 7 right now. And I think what you may see on the Skank side is they may try to take the air out of the ball right now and slow it down. I think Coach Steve Levasseur, it looked like I was seeing him say before, let's run some time off the clock and use the foul line.
Well, I think Skank could have used that timeout as well as Callis. If it hadn't been called by Callis, Skank probably could have called a timeout in that situation anyway to tell them to, kind of settle down a little bit, because they were still racing in there and putting shots up when they have a 7-point lead.
Okay, I believe this is in the, it looks to be the Skank huddle. And they're going to get the ball, getting the ball out of bounds. Some type of an inbound play there that he's setting up, as right now they're stacking at the foul line in their press breaker.
Callis will put real intense pressure on now. Cotter giving to Mankowski. See if they can get it up in the forecourt. Now they lose it out of bounds.
A minute 11. Now they've got some kids that can shoot the three-pointer, and we'll look to see Panette probably try to fire one up. Mulholland takes it in.
Can't find room. Comes back outside to Cole. Back into Mulholland. She'll go in the lane and put it up and in and out. Rebound down to Clark. The fist. 56 seconds, and Skank will have championship number 3. 7-point lead.
And they're just eating it up right now. Callis probably going to come out, see if they can't stop that clock.
Mahalan draws the foul, and it puts Stephanie Cotter back on the line.
And that's number 5 on Mulholland, and all the Callis fans up on their feet right now. As Becky Mulholland has fouled out of the ballgame with 43 seconds to go, she's being replaced by Dupuy. Danielle Dupuy checking in for her. See the lob pass coming into Carter. And Mulholland right now at that point trying to stop the clock, trying to deny the ball. This overall team strength of Skank again has pulled it out for them.
Looks like they're going to come up with third title in a row for the same group of ball players. This will go on the line now for Skank.
We oftentimes, Keith, compare teams to teams of the past, but with the Skank team, they're the same players, basically.
You compare them to themselves 2 years ago, they must have improved, but yet they won the Eastern Main title 2 years ago. Okay, Panette with it. Again, each team is 17-1 coming into the tournament. Good seasons for both clubs. Up and in by Clark. 25 seconds. 5-point game knocked out of bounds. And a foul on Hinton.
And Hinton picks up her, it looks like her first foul. So right now, barring a miracle comeback by Callis, with a few three-pointers they could do it here, but Stephanie Fisk on the line right now. And remember, in the semifinals, she was able to ice the game for him from the line. We'll see what she does here. Bang.
Now we need 2 3-pointers to tie it. Here's a big shot here.
I think they wanted a timeout, but the ball had already been given to the shooter, and no timeout can be called at that point.
But Cotter gets it back, and she's fouled.
Boy, that's not the person you want on the line. Although with the Skank team, I'm not really sure who you do want on the line. All excellent foul shooters. And I think we're going to see a timeout here. And the last few times down now, when we expected to see the three-point shot, Callis was taking it inside. Right now, they may be trying to set up some three-point opportunities.
Well, Callis made the mistake of letting Cotter get in that time. And she got the rebound and drew the foul. Maybe it's academic anyway, since Callis is down by 6. It would take
Well, they definitely needed a possession there.
A couple of quick baskets and maybe a three-pointer and a steal and another three-pointer or something. That's nearly impossible at this point. And with Carter going on the line, if she can extend it to seven, it's pretty much over.
It's going to make it very difficult for Callis. Seconds left, and Skank trying to hold on to their six-point lead. Stephanie Kider on the line to see if she can stretch that out a little bit.
Okay. 60-53, 7-point margin. If that's the actual score, but we know it's a big Skank lead regardless. 61-53. 22 seconds and a timeout.
They're taking their last timeout here. Callis is.
Okay, is this a timeout to let some other people play, or?
Well, I'm not quite sure. Looking over, he doesn't have any timeouts left. Coming over, talking to the girls. And over on the other side, Coach Steve Lavassa telling his girls, basically, let's just get the ball and run the clock off. 22 seconds left.
There's Bob McShane maybe just saying, try to go for the three-pointers. Just throw it up as soon as you get across mid-court. Skank's still going to put a little pressure on. For that, there's three-point shot going out of bounds. Skank will have it back with 15 seconds left.
And they're going to put the pressure on. Full court pressure.
Second into fist.
Hey, they don't give up in Callis.
No way. Spearman tied up at a foul.
That foul's going to be on Cole. So Spearman now gets her chance on the line.
Well, down by seven before. By eight, Callis had no intentions of giving up, calling a timeout to talk about something else, even though it's almost impossible to pull it off.
Well, I think one of the things he may have said was, "Look, girls, we've got a great season here. Keep your heads high. Let's go out and pull out the way we got here as winners." Right now, Stephanie Carter just got taken out of the game to a nice round of applause. You know, the Callis team, they came in and they've been matched up against a very powerful Skank team. I'm sure there's a lot of pride in Callis, and there's
long
a three-point
one by
attempt.
Hinton. 1 second. That's it.
And the celebration on the Skank side. They've been able to do it, Keith. Unbelievable.
The Skank Wolverine getting in the act. And the cheerleaders and another Eastern Maine plaque will be handed out in just a moment to the Skank Wolverines, Coach Steve Lavassa. Both teams entering the tournament with 17-1 records, seeded number one and number two, Callis the higher seed this year.
As we get a look at the net coming down, there's Fisk up on top. She and Spearman on one end, and down on the other end, we've got Mankowski. And trying to get a look at who's on. There's Carter on the other side. Keith, I think the key to that game really was in the second half. We talked about how they were going to get a balanced scoring attack, and that team really came alive and showed their teamwork. Starting right out, I think each player scored in that third period, and they really started to hit the nets as shooting percentages went way up in that third period.
Mankowski had a couple of big buckets in the third period, and then from then on, it seemed to be really sort of a turning point, because after Mankowski put those down, they were able to get into Carter easier, and she began to do more damage inside, and Spearman was able to get free for shots. That seemed to turn things around, and then Callis just was unable to do the job on Skank beyond that. I think Skank might have been a little bit concerned early in the ball game when they weren't able to shoot from outside.
Yeah, I think, well, they were a little bit cold, and so again they were trying to go inside to Stephanie. But as we saw last year in this tournament, it was the overall team efforts, and it's really tough to stop the five personnel.
For your obvious support of girls basketball. Let's give them one final round of applause. Congratulations to both teams. I'd also like to take just a minute to thank the members of the Principals Association that work on this committee, and Mr. Woodrow Bailey, and all of the many others that have made this tournament as important as it is to all of Eastern Maine. Thank you, folks. At this time, Mr. Norris Nickerson will do the awards presentation.
We'd ask Coach McShane and Coach Wedge to come up from Calis, please.
Coach Bob McShane and Sonia Wedge.
As we call your team members up, please come up and receive your individual awards. First, the managers, Heidi Wunder. Robin Spearin. Emily Fletcher. Okay, team members, Betsy Olson. Wendy Rogue. Julie Olson. Danielle Dupuy. Melanie Levitt. Trisha Carter. Colby Lyon. Crystal Hinton. Becky Mulholland.
Mulholland, only a sophomore, did an excellent job in this tournament.
Well, she'll probably lead the Callis Blue Devils back here in the future.
Kim Cole. Jennifer Bennett. And Paula Clark.
Good game for Clark.
Steve Levaster.
As we call your members up, please come and receive your individual award.
Scott Lowell.
First, the managers, Nita Floyd. Melanie Cassie.
On both sides as a Callis
Don
and Skank fans are up on their feet. Job by the Skank Wolverines. I'd like to mention for the Callis Lady Blue Devil fans, a reception will be held at the Callis for the Callis girls and their cheerleaders at the Callis High School cafeteria at approximately 11:30 tonight. All friends and fans of the Lady Blue Devils are invited, and they have a lot to celebrate. And so, as we await the interviews, we'll be back to the Bangor Auditorium in just a moment.
Production and broadcast of the high school BC&D basketball tournament games on MPBN are made possible in part by grants from Grants Dairy, processing milk produced by Central, Eastern, and Northern Maine dairy farmers since 1902. Husson College, offering master's, baccalaureate, and associate degrees in business and professional studies. R.H. Foster Incorporated, with locations in Machias, Hamden, Lisbon, and Caribou. Mobile distributors throughout Maine. Machias Savings Bank, the total service bank. And McDonald's Restaurants of Maine.
Okay, back at the Bangor Auditorium, and you see the Skank girls getting their pictures taken, and the number ones being shown there. They've done what many teams would think impossible, but... It seems every year, Keith, the Skank Wolverines come out on top.
Three times in a row, the same ball players, two state titles and three Eastern Maine titles now, and a chance to make it three gold balls for the trophy case at Skank High School.
Again, the best thing about this is, and the thing that you really like to see was a great all-around team effort. And I that's the key for any program that continues to win, and that's what they've been able to do at Skank.
Okay, coming right up here at the Bangor Auditorium, the boys' C final between John Babst and Washington Academy.
Okay, Bill has Coach Steve Levasseur on the sidelines. Bill?
Lisa, thank you very much. Steve said for the first time in 3 years he's got the net. They gave it to him. Steve, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
What do you attribute to besides Stephanie Carter? She was the one that came through at the end, but you had a great team effort from all the girls. A little close in the beginning.
I think you've got to give a lot of credit to the point guard, Stephanie Fisk, for controlling our offense. And the Mankowski girl opened it up from the outside for us in the second half. She stuck about four there, and we just started to roll after that.
Callis played well, Steve.
Callis is a great team. We met two good teams in the year, Holland and Callis, and you can't take anything away from them. They played hard. They did a super job.
Is the third time better than the first or second?
I think this time is because now we've got a chance to do something that's never been done before in girls basketball, and that's a chance to win a state three state championships in a row. And we're just going to hope we can come down here next week and play good ball.
Was it as much fun?
Oh, definitely. Every year, it's more and more fun. I guess this year is a little special to me because I had seven of these girls back 3 years ago, and they're now going to be leaving me after next week, and a little sentimental.
Well, Steve, you did a great job up to East Millinock, and I'm sure the fans are real proud because of the turnout you had here. And on behalf of MPBN, we'd like to present you with this videotape of tonight's game. You can take it back to the school and enjoy it, and bring back the gold ball next week.
Thank you very much.
You're more than welcome. Lisa?
Thank you, Bill. We want to take a look at a little bit of that scoring right now. And for the Callis Blue Devils, it was Paula Clark leading the way with 20 points. She was followed by Jennifer Panette with 15. Becky Mulholland, the sophomore, had 13. And Allison Saunders chipped in 3, followed by Crystal Hinton with 2 points for their total of 53 points in a very well-played ball game for Callis. But the Skank all-around team effort paid off for them. Stephanie Carter ended up with 31 big points. And again, the key that Coach Steve Levasseur was talking about, Dawn Mankowski really started to light up in the second half. She had 10 points. Darcy Clark also had 10. That's their super freshman. And Stephanie Fisk, who as the point guard ran the offense, she had 7. Lori Sperrin chipped in 6 for their total of 63 points. Again, the final score in that game, Skank coming out on top, 63-53 over Callis.
Okay, well, that's the scoring. I was looking at Stephanie Carter's records in the past. She already has some records. And she scored a record 128 points in the tournament in 1987. However, that included a playoff game. She does, however, hold the record for most points scored in one game at 46 last year, 1988 tourney, and the most free throws scored in the original tournament, 45 by Stephanie Carter. So she has a few records in Class C basketball. This time around, I believe it was 79 points in 3 games. So
she's definitely left her mark, and it was kind of nice to see at the end when they were giving the award to Stephanie, many of the Callis fans up and on their feet, and I happened to pick out a little girl in the crowd up there, and it was almost like at some point she set a good example for many of the kids, and maybe giving them something to work towards.
Okay, we leave you now. From the you'll come back in a few moments, or stay with us for boys basketball, the Class C final coming right up between John Babst and Washington Academy. Again, the score of this one is 63-53, Skank winning another Eastern Maine title.